Nick, do you need me on the mic to be able to pick everything up?
Nope, you were just fine.
Okay, good. Cheers. Good, good, good. I don't want to really upset the apple cart, but I would. It might be nice if you gathered closer a little bit. I have to do this with the kids. And then we can all especially experience this together, and then we have a discussion at the end. I would feel it. You can sit on the front row if you want. It's pretty good. And thank you all for
Dan and Noah.
It says a lot about you and your families and how you care about our children, your children, and this school. And in true Holy Trinity fashion, let's open up in prayer. So if you'll bow your heads with me, please. Our Lord, we ask for your guidance as we carry out the most important job we have, to be parents and grandparents to your precious children. May we do all we can to protect them and guide them to become productive citizens so they may carry your light into this world surrounded in darkness. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We're very excited to be able to host this program this evening. We all know that parenting is different these days, even since the time I was a parent to the time you're a parent. It's more difficult. And we are so blessed to have a wonderful resource here with our Brevard County Sheriff's Department, and specifically Wayne Ivey, our sheriff. Wayne has been my friend for 15 to 20 years. Well, 25 maybe. It's been a lot. When were you? How long has it been since you've been with FDLE?
Oh, God. Well, I was with FDLE starting in 1993.
Yeah, okay. So I knew him back then. But I have watched him become a premier leader here in Brevard County. And I'm here to tell you, no one cares more about the safety of your children than Sheriff Wayne Ivey. He tirelessly does presentations like this and works with parents and works with schools, and we're so very grateful to him and all of the sheriffs. And so we are very proud to host him tonight. And as I was thinking about this, frankly, the more we learn tonight and the better job we do as parents, the easier his job is. So there you go. So let me turn the program over to the Sheriff's Department, and I hope you enjoy it.
Today's parents and kids face challenges like never before. Drugs, gangs, bullying, and even social media have completely changed our ability to keep watch over our kids and hold them accountable for their actions. Today's parenting is 24 hours a day and one of the most demanding jobs in the world. As a parent of four, I know how hard it is to tough love your kid. But as a veteran of law enforcement for over 34 years, I know that going to visit your child in prison is even harder, and coming to see them here is unimaginable. Unfortunately, in today's society, those may just be the only choices you have. That's why it's important for you to have every tool possible to be your child's personal cop. Thank you for joining us for this presentation, and now it's time to be a parent again.
All right, good evening, everybody.
So I'm going to start out where I always do, and that is to say thank you for allowing me to serve as your sheriff. I love this job. It is the funnest thing I have ever done in my entire life. And one of the things that makes this job so great is I'm surrounded by 1,500 amazing men and women that are knocking it out of the park out there to keep you safe. So if you see one of our team out there, I don't care what role they play in this agency, it's vital to our success. Let them know how much you appreciate what they're doing, because they're truly, truly doing a great job for you. I've got a few of them with me. I want to introduce them just real quick. Joe Downs is actually one of our reserve deputies. Joe is also the president of Triad, which handles all of our efforts to help our seniors and our Project Lifesaver. But Joe also, when we first started this program, he said, I want to be a part of this, and he took the bull by the horns and started becoming the facilitator for the program. Joe puts in on average about 1,000 hours of volunteer reserve duty every year. So please give Joe a big round of applause. In the back, I've got Noel Remillard, who is one of our managers. And Noel actually was very instrumental in starting the chain game as we got the program up and running. So you'll see a little bit more of Noel and his team. I've got Carissa LaRoche, who is one of our crime prevention specialists and our deputies out of our crime prevention unit. And you heard me say earlier that I have 1,500 amazing men and women. I actually have 1,501 employees. So Miguel Melendez is the one. He's really not that amazing. he's with us. I mean, he's a good guy. But actually, Miguel is a great member of our team. He's part of our crime prevention unit, too. And you'll be seeing a lot more of he and Chris as we go through. So let's talk about why we're here tonight. And first of all, I want to thank you for having us and putting this on. You know, one of the things that I tell everybody is that I believe society has unintentionally robbed parents of their ability to be parents. And I believe that with all my heart. You know, we live in a world today where parents aren't sure if they can do it or not. They're not sure of the things. And we'll talk about all this as we go through. But the reality of this program came about because I started getting calls. Right after I first became sheriff, I would get calls from parents that were just distressed. They didn't know what to do. And a couple of them that stand out in my mind was a parent that said, Sheriff, my son won't get on the bus, and I don't know what to do. And I said, well, how old is he? And she said, 6. And I said, well, what do you mean you don't know what to do? Whip his butt. Put him on the bus. And she said, oh, I'll get in trouble for it. And it registered with me that she believed that if she was proper parenting and proper disciplining, she would get in trouble. The second one that came to me was a parent that said, my 13-year-old daughter won't give me the password to her laptop so that I can check up on her. What should I do? That was a simple fix for me. Take it out in the garage, run over it with your car. That way she won't need a password, and neither will you. But she also was afraid they were going to get in trouble. And that's just not the case. All right? That's not. You're going to see tonight what parents have the ability to do. And then we're going to talk about the challenges of what parents must do in today's time. I'm gonna filter in or sprinkle in a little bit of my own personal upbringing, my own personal philosophies about parenting. And then at the end of this program, I'm going to bring in our chain gang. And they're going to sit before you, 8 members of our chain gang that are unscripted. I don't have a clue who we're bringing. I don't have a clue what they're going to say. But whatever they're going to say is going to be to questions you ask them. You're going to just stand up and fire away. And take this opportunity to walk away tonight listening to experts on how you get in jail. That's what I want you to walk away with tonight. And trust me when I tell you, they're here because they want to be, not because I make them. They don't have to come do this program. They volunteer to come do it because their ideal situation is that what they tell you tonight will one day keep somebody else from going into their shoes, because they don't want to be there and they don't want anybody else in that. So let's start out. Why are we here? All right, there's 5 types of parents, all right? And we're gonna try and identify them. Those that are doing it right. How many of you feel like you're fit into that mold? How many of you feel like you're doing it right? All right, got a few hands up. All right, that's good. All right, those that are doing it wrong, how many of you think you fit into that? All right, okay, some of the same hands I just saw. I'm a little bit concerned about that. Those that are, slow it down for me just a little bit. Those that are unsure how to do it, how many of you fit into that mold? Okay, and that's generally the biggest audience we see, is those that are unsure how to do it. And so, again, society is creating a little bit of that. Those that are scared to do it, all right? And when we talk about scared to do it, we're not talking about just, and I say just, we're not talking about just being scared of the child now being bigger than you are, because that is one of the fears we see, especially with single parents, that their teenager is now bigger than they are and might be able to do physical harm on them versus the other. We're also talking about some other fears. One of those is that my child won't love me anymore, all right? And that is a fear that a lot of parents have. All right? In fact, I can remember as a kid growing up, you know, I would think, man, my parents are the meanest people on earth, all right? How many, let's just go ahead and get this out right now. How many of you parents, all right, actually as you were growing up, in the midst of crying, went, I hope my parents get hit by a truck, all right? It's all right, go ahead, put your hands up, because you know you did, all right? And they never got hit by a truck. You didn't love them, everything else. That's one fear that parents have. Another fear in today's time, when we see 50% of our families are from divorce, is we see parents that are scared their child may want to go live with the other parent who is not as strict on them. And what we also see is that happens to be the reverse psychology in this, that children want fences. They want somebody that's going to hold them accountable and teach them right from wrong. So those are the fears that we see that often fit into that category. And then the last one, those that don't care. Now, I've been a law enforcement officer for 39 years. So I'm going to point out, and I'm not trying to pick on anybody. I'm not. Please don't take this offensively. But I'm going to point out the parents that I see sitting here tonight that fit into that last category. They're sitting right there, and they're sitting right there, and right there, and right there, and right there. Because they didn't care enough to be here tonight. They didn't care enough to say, I want every tool I possibly can to help hold my children accountable. Because that's what this is about. It's about teaching our children there are consequences for their actions. Now, before we go any more, let me just say this. Nothing else in this presentation is going to tell you to whip your kid's butt. Not a single thing. There's nothing else in this presentation is going to tell you not to either. You have to start holding your kid accountable. And we'll talk about it as we go through. Why are we doing this? Because every one of us care about this community. You heard earlier that how much I love our kids and how much I believe in something very strongly. I'm convicted to it. And that is that we, law enforcement, parents, principals, all of us together collectively have to get to these kids before they get to me. Once they get to me, we're in trouble. We're trying to now get them out of a system that if we'd have kept them out of, we'd have had less problems. So we got to get to these kids before they get to me. Now, I see some of you have brought your kids with you, all right? And I'll go ahead and tell you that that always concerns me because one day they're going to be 18 and they're not going to want to vote for me after they see this presentation. So, but they will come back around and vote for me later after they become parents. I promise you that as we go through this. All right. Parenting choices. Here we go. It's hard to tough love your kids. All right. How many of you tough love your kids? Okay. Now, when we talk about tough loving our kids, the first thing that we have to understand is your parents used to tell you, this is going to hurt me more than it hurts you, right? How many of you heard that from your parents? Mm-hmm. And how many of you believed it? You were like, no, it's not. You're hurting me. But today, as parents, we look back, and guess what? It hurts to discipline your child. It absolutely does. It hurts to discipline them because you know, one, that it's hurting them. Two, you're fearful that it's going to damage the relationship you have with them, on and on and on. It's hard to tough love your kid, but I promise you, it's not as hard as going to visit them in our jail. Every day of my life when I'm at our facility, I see parents, grandparents, coming down the long walk that leads up to the doors. And if I stop and talk to them, they've been there to get their child out of jail or to visit their child that's in jail. It's brutal. It absolutely is. The parents, the grandparents, they hurt just as bad, if not more, than the person that's sitting in the jail. Because they question themselves, did I do something wrong? Was there something I could have done different to keep this from happening? It's tough to go see them. But even as tough as it is to tough love your kid and to go visit them in jail, it pales in comparison to going to see them in the cemetery. And that is something I pray no one ever has to see. I have a lady that comes around and speaks with us on occasion. And unfortunately in her life, she has experienced all three of those. She had three children. One of them went off the path, got arrested, actually did prison time for drugs, did his time, got out, was rehabilitated, was doing great, had gotten married, had a job, everything was going right. And he got killed in a motorcycle wreck. He wasn't doing anything wrong. He wasn't drinking. He wasn't on drugs. He actually wasn't even at fault in the accident. So she's experienced all three of those. And when she tells her story, it's gut-wrenching to hear of what she went through in each one of those emotions. We're trying to avoid those emotions. That's what we're trying to avoid with this program. All right, so what is discipline? The practice of training others to follow rules or a code of behavior using punishment to correct disobedience. Now, I always tell myself, and I keep forgetting to do it, that one day I'm going to add on to this slide that stops at the age of 18, because that's when discipline stops, right? It doesn't? When does discipline stop? It never stops. That's exactly right. And since it never stops, then as parents, it's important for us to lay the foundation. If we're building a house of discipline, what's the strongest part of the house? What must it be? The foundation. So we have to start laying that foundation at a very young age. If the foundation's weak and then you try to build a house on top of it, it collapses. And discipline doesn't stop at 18. If Joe doesn't come to work, he doesn't get paid. Well, he doesn't get paid anyway, never mind. If Noel doesn't come to work, he doesn't get paid. If Carissa comes to work late, she gets disciplined. If you break the law, you get disciplined. If you don't pay your bills, there's a form of discipline with it. On and on and on. So discipline doesn't stop when we're 18. As parents, our ability to discipline stops at 18. That's what we have to understand, that connection. All right, parents' role. Here's the characteristics of parents. Loving. How many of you feel like you're loving parents? Go ahead and throw your hands up. All right? I always like to ask some of the kids that are in the audience or younger, how many of you feel like your parents are loving? All right, we got a split decision up here. I got one in the back, too. All right? Responsibility. As a parent, you have to teach your children responsibility and accountability. Those two go hand in hand. And we do that by how? Showing them the right ethics, the right character, everything else. We do it by actually dropping down to number four, the role model that we are. That's how we teach our children those three things. And when it comes to loving, how do we teach our children to love? We teach them by loving them. And teach them, a lot of times parents will say, my children never hang up the phone without saying I love you. They never tell me, they never leave my house or leave where we are without saying I love you. That's a great testament to what they've learned. My children, my son is 33, he's a state trooper. Never ever do he and I talk on the phone or see each other and we leave, we don't hug, and he tells me he loves me and I tell him I love him. But there's more than just saying I love you. There's I love you in your actions. Guys, you may want to remember that. Valentine's Day is coming up. Just keep that fresh on your memory. The last one is communicator. We don't realize it, but as a parent, we need to teach our children to be strong communicators. We need to have them have the ability to articulate to us what's going on in their lives, to communicate with their teachers, to communicate with society, but more importantly, we need to listen to them as well. The Bible tells us that God gave us two ears and one mouth, right? So we need to be quick to listen and slow to speak. Doesn't mean you can't speak to your children. It means you need to listen to what's going on. Because their message to you might be a critical message that you missed the punctuation point on. So make sure that you've taught them to communicate by communicating with them. And part of that is not watching TV while they're trying to talk to you. How many of you have done that? It's all right. All right? I do it all the time. Don't. Let your kids know that they're the primary focus in your life. You want them to be their primary focus, don't you? Don't you want your children to want the absolute best for them and those around them? So we have to teach them how to communicate. You want them to also be able to come to you and tell you something bad is happening in their life. If they don't believe they can come to you and tell you that something's going bad in their life, then you're never going to know what you could have stopped, what you could have helped with. So we want to teach them to be. This really comes down to this. I shouldn't have to be the chief law enforcement officer in your child's life. You are. You are with them 24 hours a day. By the time one of us gets to them, we're already in a bad situation. So you are the chief law enforcement officer in your child's life. That's what I want you to leave. In fact, tonight when you leave, you are going to be co-deputy sheriffs in raising your child's life. All right? You're going to see how that works in just a little bit. Life affords no greater responsibility, no greater privilege than the raising of the next generation. C. Everett Koop. Anybody know who C. Everett Koop was or still is? All right, he was the Surgeon General for the United States many, many years ago. That's a very profound statement. This is our opportunity to raise the next generation of parents. The next generation of leaders in our country is within our grasp, our ability to teach them that there's consequences for your actions. To teach them responsibility, to teach them accountability, to teach them to love. There is no better opportunity. I don't care what job you're in. I don't care what it is. There is no greater opportunity afforded to you than the ability to teach your kids. All right? Law enforcement's role was historically to arrest criminals, but today we've morphed into being parents, mentors, and guidance counselors for kids. Time for parents to once again be re-empowered to be the chief law enforcement officer in their child's life. And I said at the very beginning of this, I believe society has unintentionally robbed you of those abilities. I think we have to get back to where parents know it's okay to discipline your children. You got to know that the word responsibly attaches to it. Because if you're disciplining them from an irresponsible mechanism, that is not okay. And we'll talk a little bit about that as we go through right now. All right, so let me put a little bit of my own story in here. My mom and dad were the chief law enforcement officers in my life. In fact, the way it worked at our house was my mom was the sheriff, the judge, and the executioner in the Ivey household. My father was her witness to what happened. So when HRS, which is DCF now, when HRS showed up at the house, dad's like, oh no, it didn't happen like that. He was mom's witness, all right? Mom was the one you feared in the house. Mom didn't play. My mom became a school bus driver so she could drive me to and from school every day of my life. I wish I was kidding, I'm not. I've never ridden a school bus that my mom was not the driver of. Even to the point I wrestled and played football. And when we would go to away matches and away games, my mom would volunteer to drive the bus for free so she could watch her child. Her bus monitor on those wrestling and football trips was my dad, who sat in the front seat right there. When you got on the bus, I would try to get to the back with all the knuckleheads, all right? I'd try and disguise myself and not look and everything. And my father would only do one thing as I got on the bus. If he was sitting there, he would look at that seat as I walked by and he'd go. And I would sit in that seat. And that's where I sat while everybody else was in the back having fun and doing the things that they were doing. And I hated it. I absolutely felt horrible because my mom was the bus driver and my dad was the bus monitor on those trips. And I didn't get to go have fun. That was how I was brought up. Let me tell you something. My parents, they were a team. All right? They worked together. My dad, my mom put all of her emphasis on taking us to church and making sure our grades were right. My dad put his emphasis on our character, on our behavior. Dad didn't play, all right? If mom saw you do something, if you were at Winn-Dixie and you were doing something you shouldn't have been doing, mom tore your butt up right there. And then, when you got home, dad tore your butt up. Not for what you did at Winn-Dixie, but he got on you because you embarrassed mom and made her do that. That was my life. My mom wrote me up one time. Sent me to the dean because I slapped a boy on the bus. As soon as I did it, she stopped the bus on the side of the road, brought me up front, made me sit in the front seat. We got to school, she let everybody off. Yeah, we were on the way to school, I was already in trouble. Got to school, she got everybody off the bus. She pops me, says, how'd that feel? I said, not very good. Then she wrote me up and sent me to the dean. The dean looked at it and said, boy, if your own mama wrote you up, it must have been really bad. He gave me 3 licks. When I got back on the bus, my mom made me sit on the front seat for 2 weeks and I couldn't talk. That almost killed me. And then when we got home, my dad tore my butt up for embarrassing my mom and making her send me to the dean. How embarrassing that must have been for her. That was the day I decided to become a police officer. I was like, this has got to be illegal. There's got to be something wrong with this. There's no way this is legal. But that was my parents' way. My dad taught us character. He taught us to respect our mom. Rule number one. Respect your mom. In fact, my dad would always tell his son, if you don't respect your mom, you won't respect anybody, including yourself. Dads, I believe that's our job, to teach them to do just that. My father didn't put as much emphasis on our education because he knew mom had it handled. He didn't put as much emphasis on going to church and everything because he knew mom had that side handled. His was on character. His was on behavior. I remember one time, I was a freshman in high school, I brought home my first report card with all A's on it. Actually, it was the only report card I ever brought home with all A's on it. However, on the other side, it had all N's for needs improvement in citizenship. I walked in, I handed my father a report card. He's sitting at our little breakfast nook. He had his glasses down on his nose, as he often did. He's looking at the report card, he's looking at me, looks back at it. He finally says, son, what do these N's mean? I said, Dad, you know what those mean. He said, they mean you can't behave in class. Can't keep your mouth shut. I said, Dad, I had my plan, all right? I said, Dad, if I'm making straight A's, how is it I could be misbehaving? That's just not possible. And my father looked at me and he said, son, Even somebody that's not very smart can be quiet. As smart as you are, you better be the quietest kid in that class from this day forward. If not, when you come home, I'm going to kill you. Now, how many of you, and let's just be honest, we're all out here being honest, how many of you have ever threatened to kill your kids? Go ahead, it's all right. Now, my father actually drew it up one time, how he was going to pull it off. I think he took it a little bit far, all right? But yeah, we do. We think that in our minds. Why? Because we want them to be so awesome that we become disappointed in their actions. We love them so much. We want them to have a better life than what we've had, and most of us have had a good life. So that's the reality of it. My father was just incredible. Until the day he died, he was my best friend. I lost my dad in 1997 to cancer. And I often think about how many times I sat on that bus seat wishing I didn't have to sit there and talk to my dad on the way to those football games and wrestling matches. And I would give anything in my life to have that opportunity for 5 minutes to sit next to that man. Just anything. I lost my best friend that day. But my dad had a unique ability about him, and I encourage each of you to do this. My dad never let being my best friend get in the way of being my dad. I had a whole school to pick best friends from. I only had 2 people to pick parents from. And so, yeah, my dad was my best friend until it came time to be dad. And then he was hardcore dad, and then we moved on. He taught me another lesson in my life, and I encourage each of you to please take this to grasp. That after the discipline happens, go play ball with your kid. Go do something with your kid. Go grab a sandwich with your kid. Let them know that you're not upset with them. Let them know that you love them. It's good for them, and it's also good for you. It's cleansing. My father taught me that. My dad, as I said, my dad was my best friend. One day, my wife, who never got the chance to meet my father, she said, "What was your dad like?" And I was telling her some of this, and I said, "He was the only man I ever feared in my life." And she goes, "That's so sad that you feared your dad." No, it wasn't that kind of fear. I feared letting him down. I feared disappointing him. I feared losing his respect. It wasn't a physical fear. It was an emotional fear of, I want him to be proud of me. That's, as parents, what we're reaching for with our kids. That's what we want to walk away with. All right, so where does being their best friend go wrong? Where does that start to go sideways? We're going to watch 3 quick video clips. And Dr. Cobb, I apologize beforehand for the content of a couple of these videos, but I promise you it will not get too bad here. So let's play the first one. All right, who is that? Hold on for that. Who is that?
Miley Cyrus,
all right, Hannah Montana actually back then. All right, as a parent, would any of you have had a problem with that being your child? Anybody? Yeah. All right, let's watch the second one. How about that one? As a parent, would any of you have had a problem with that? And to those that don't have a problem with it, are we starting to get there? All right, let's watch the third one. About that one. And here's the biggest problem. She had a dad that was in the industry. She had a dad that used to brag to everybody that his best thing going in life was that he was his best friend, or he was the best friend to his daughter. That's what mattered to him. If you look later, after things started to go bad, he says, "How many interviews did I give and say, you know what's important between me and Miley is to be a friend to my kids? I said it a lot. Sometimes I would even read other parents saying, you don't need to be a friend, you need to be a parent. Well, I'm the first guy to say to them right now, you were right. I should have been a better parent. I should have said enough is enough. It's getting dangerous and somebody's going to get hurt. I should have, but I didn't. Honestly, I didn't know the ball was out of bounds until it was way up in the stands somewhere." If you didn't know that ball was out of bounds, you weren't at the game. Because that ball was going way out of bounds a long time before it actually landed. As parents, we have to be parents first. Being best friends is great. Every one of us wants to embrace and embody that and say, I'm my child's best friend. But the reality of it is, you're your child's parent. And that is your first responsibility. It's a responsibility you gladly took. Being best friend is icing on the cake. You got to be the parent first. All right? Parenting today versus yesterday. Now, we're going to watch a video clip. And some of you are going to resonate very well with this video clip. Some of you are going to look like a deer in the headlights going, what are they talking about? All right? It's going to depend on when you were born as to what part of that you walk away with. Joe, please.
I can't believe we made it. According to today's regulators and bureaucrats, those of us who were kids in the 50s, 60s, 70s, or even early 80s probably should not have survived. Our baby cribs were covered with bright-colored lead-based paint. We had no childproof lids or locks on medicine bottles, doors, or cabinets. And when we rode our bikes, we had no helmets. We drank water from the garden hose and not from a bottle. We ate cupcakes, bread, and butter, and drank soda with lots of sugar in it. But we were rarely overweight because we were always outside playing. We would leave home in the morning to play all day, as long as we were back when the streetlights came on. No one was able to reach us all day. Smartphones? We didn't have cell phones at all. No PlayStations, Xboxes, limitless channels on cable, laptops or tablets. Facebook was an actual face and an actual book. We had friends. We went outside and found them. We played dodgeball, and sometimes the ball would hurt. We fell out of trees, got cut, and broke bones and teeth. And there were no lawsuits from these accidents. No one was to blame but us. Remember accidents? We had fights and punched each other and got black and blue and learned to get over it. We made up games with sticks and tennis balls. And although we were told it would happen, we didn't put out any eyes. We rode bikes or walked to a friend's home, knocked on the door, rang the bell, or just walked right in and talked to him. Little League had tryouts, and not everyone made the team. Those who didn't had to learn to deal with disappointment. Some students weren't as smart as others, so they failed a grade and were held back to repeat the same grade. Tests were not adjusted for any reason. Our actions were our own. Consequences were expected. The idea of parents bailing us out if we got in trouble in school or broke a law was unheard of. They actually sided with the school or the law. Imagine that. Now, this generation has produced some of the best risk takers, problem solvers, and inventors ever. We had freedom, failure, success, and responsibility, and we learned how to deal with it. If you've related to anything that was just said, you're one of them. Congratulations. You made it.
How many of you resonate with that? All right. Now, at the end of that, he says four things. We had freedom. As kids growing up, we did have freedom. But our kids today have even more freedom. All right? He says we had failure. Yeah, we had failures back then. You didn't make the baseball team, or you didn't pass because you didn't make the grade. Whatever it was, we had failures. If you look today, we've almost dismissed failure from the year. Kids aren't allowed to fail anymore. Failing is a great part of learning. You look at today, kids, there's a great commercial out there. I love to watch this commercial. It's a commercial that shows a dad, I want to say it's an insurance commercial or something, but the dad goes and picks his son up, or they're at a football awards thing, and they get the trophy, and it says participation award. And the dad goes, participation award? We won every game. And he rips the participation thing off, takes a marker, and writes on there, champions. Well, guess what? We've quit teaching kids to become champions. We've quit teaching them that you've got to work to become a champion. We've taken that off the table. Same thing with school. All of those things. We have to get back where failure is there, but you can work through it and not fail. That's the lesson. It says we had freedom for failure, success. Success is greater opportunities for success today than any of us ever had. No matter what, you can pick any type of thought, and I promise you that there's a greater opportunity for success today than there was when most of us were growing up. Opportunity is the same thing. So what it really boils down to is we've taken off the table hard work. That's what it really comes down to. We've made it easy. And you know what? For some parents, we've made it easy too, because instead of us tending to our kids, we let the PlayStation do it. Instead of us being deeply engaged, we aren't anymore, because we have everything else going on in our lives. So next slide. Let's talk about the society and the social evolution has begun. In fact, Joe, you go ahead and put all those up there for me. All right, let's talk about the social evolution first. How many of you are better at technology than your children are? Go ahead and raise your hand. No, seriously, one person right here. I'm guessing you're an IT person, is that? Yeah, okay, all right. That's kind of like cheating a little bit, all right? But it's all right, I'm with you. All right, so most of us, in fact, how many of you have a Facebook page? How many of you have Twitter, Instagram, KitKat? I don't know the rest of it. How many of you had to get your children to set up your account for you when you first started? That's exactly right. It kind of reminds me of when they first came out with the child-proof prescription bottles. The kids were the only ones that could open it. Literally, my dad would bring, open this for me, open it up, give it to him. It's the same thing with the social evolution that's taking place. Social evolution has taken over the world. Even in our own world, we use social media like crazy. Our outreach through social media, with the push of a button, we reach 150,000 people through social media. For everything it is good, it also has those bad sides to it as well. So we have to stop counting on it, use it for what it's good for, but not let it overtake. You saw earlier in the video where they said, we didn't play video games, we were outside playing. Get your kids outside. When my oldest boy was growing up and they came out with some of the Nintendos and stuff like that, I had a rule with him. You get to buy minutes, and you get to buy minutes by how many miles you run this week, how many pull-ups you do, how many sit-ups you do, all of these other things. And in the minutes he got to buy, he got to play on the game. So I had him outside doing stuff, but I was also trying to give him a little bit of what he wants. Let's talk about those video games for a minute, all right? The best way I can say this is, how many of you played war when you were growing up? How many of you played cowboys and Indians when you were growing up? Did it make you violent? Did any of you decide you wanted to go do bad stuff? No. You know what the difference is? And I'm not blaming this all on video games, but I do believe there is a connection to some of this. The difference is, when we were playing war and we were playing cowboys and Indians, we were outside playing with our friends. We were outside going to do these things with people we went to school with, we rode the bus with. Actually, we were going to play with people that we knew. Today, those video games, they're playing with people. If you want to see your friends, your kids' friends, next time you walk in and they're playing one of those games, look up in the corner and you'll see their friends, all right? Xbox Larry or whatever the names are that are up there. That's who their friends are today. Our friends we sat outside at lunch and had a peanut butter and jelly sandwich with. You had to treat them with respect because they were your friends. You didn't get extra points for blowing one of them up. You didn't get extra points for stealing and stuff. My wife comes to me, our youngest boy, he was about to turn 14. My wife comes to me and says, hey, I got to run to Target. Michael wants a video game. And I say, cool, what are you getting? She goes, Grand Theft Auto. And literally, I looked at her and went, and she's like, it's just a video game. I'm like, it's not just a video game. She goes, Wayne, you are so paranoid about this stuff. He just wants a video game. I said, it's not just a video game. I said, do you know what it's about? She goes, yeah, stealing cars. And I'm literally, now you guys got to remember, I'm married to an Italian-Irish redhead girl. I live every day of my life in fear. But this was a strong one that I felt I needed to stand up on. So I said, come here. So we pull it up, and I show her where you get points for stealing cars and picking up drugs and guns and prostitutes and all this other stuff. And she goes, oh, my goodness. So I said, look, go to Target, get him like Barney or something like that. Neat little games that you play. But had it not been for that conversation, she was going to get him what he wanted, all right? No, you need to get them what they need. That's what you need. We want them to have fun. We want them to enjoy life, all right? But there's a barrier. There's a place we have to stop. Let's talk about communication. Ronald Reagan said that the next great idea for our country will start in conversation at the dinner table. If that is true today, it will start by text message, because that's how we communicate. Even parents, we communicate with each other mostly through text. We communicate with our children mostly through text. Remember, we're the role model. Where do you think they get it from? One night, my wife's fixing dinner, and I'm sitting at the little table there doing some emails, and she picks up her phone. I hear her phone ding. She picks it up, and I know her facial expressions, and she goes, I said, what's wrong? And as I'm saying it, she's texting back. She goes, Michael. I said, what's he doing? She goes, he's wanting to know when dinner is. He's in the room. Literally, because of the configuration of our house, he's closer to her than I am. And he's texting her. So she had texted him back. Ding, her phone goes off again. She goes, oh. I said, what's he want? She goes, he wants to know what we're having. So I get up and I start running to his room. I've already formulated my plan of how I'm going to choke him. I already got this going through my mind. She's right on my heels because she and I are miles apart when it comes to discipline. I believe in just whipping that butt, getting it over with, and we can go play basketball. She wants to put him on restriction. She wants to have the emotional talk with him. Let me tell you the problem with putting your kids on restriction. Maybe some of you do it, but here's the deal. If they're on restriction, I'm on restriction. Because now I got to watch them for 2 weeks to make sure they're not doing what they're supposed to not be doing. I'd rather just get it over with. Let's go. So we come out of there, and she goes, you know, really, him texting all the time is your fault. Of course it is. So I said, how's it my fault? She goes, because you never are without your phones. She was 1,000% right. She goes, you have your phones at the dinner table. She goes, you're always texting, everything else. And she was right. I forgot about number 4 on our list. I'm the role model. I always had my phones with me because, man, something may happen that I need to be right on. I forgot we have a house phone where the chief deputy could call me on. Somebody may need a response from a text while I'm having dinner. She was right. I was the one that was role modeling that. Put your phones down. You don't need to have your phones for that 30 or 45 minute opportunity you have to talk to your spouse and to talk to your children. Stop texting. Have a conversation with your children. Now, how many of you try to have a conversation with your child at the dinner table? How many of you do that? All right, pretty good hands. How many of you does the conversation go like this? How was your day? Fine. Oh, good. You go ahead and eat your peas. All right? I don't know about at your house, but fine means anything but okay. Because if my wife tells me her day was fine, this is what I do. I have 2 phones. I take this phone and I call this phone and I act like we have an emergency so that I can leave the house. Because it's going to be bad if my wife's day was fine. Same thing to your children. If your child tells you their day was fine, there's probably something that didn't go well. You need to dig into it. If they say it was fine, well, what was fine about it? Who'd you have lunch with? What was your favorite class today? What'd you work on? Engagement, 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 talking to them. And you'll know you've broken the barrier when you sit down at the table and your child asks you how your day was. Now you'll know that you've started communicating with your children. We have to talk to them. We have to get them engaged. Let's talk about their clothes. I know we don't have this problem here, but at some of our schools that we go around to, the children are wearing clothes that none of our parents would have ever let us leave the house in. If your child wore inappropriate clothes, it's your fault. Because A, you bought them, and B, you let them leave the house with them. Start being the chief law enforcement officer. You're not going without that. And if they call us and say, my parents are being mean to me, when we get there, if you've done it right, we're going to high-five you because we're your partners. We're not here to take their side when you're doing it right as a parent. Respect. I talked earlier about my father was so deeply believing that you had to respect your mom. Well, you also have to respect yourself. As a child growing up, you have to have self-respect. But it's our jobs as parents to teach them that, to teach them how to respect their mom. We're going to have an argument. In fact, not long ago, I was coming back from Memphis, Tennessee, and I'm sitting on the plane, and a guy comes up, sits down beside me, and my neck almost breaks because it's Coach Lou Holtz that's sitting down beside me. And I had just the most incredible conversation on the flight all the way back. And as we got off the plane, I took a picture with him, and I walked away, and a few minutes later, I hear somebody coming up running behind me, and I turn around, and it's Coach Holtz, who's got to be 80. And he's running to me. He goes, Sheriff, there's something I forgot to tell you. And I said, yes, sir, Coach, what is it? He said, one of the things that I always took great pride in, he says, we talked a lot about philosophy. He says, but one of the things I always took great pride in was I never let my children see me and their mom mad at each other. He said, always remember that. And as he walked off, I thought to myself, that man felt that was so important that he ran through this airport to share that with me. And he was 100% right. And I wish I'd always done that, but I didn't. I've made those mistakes. Today, my wife and I, we have arguments. I always lose. But we do them privately. We don't let our kids see us arguing. Because remember, we're raising that next generation of parents, which also are going to have their spouses as well. So we got to teach them. Music. How many of you listen to your child's playlist? All right. How many of you can't stand your child's playlist? That's pretty much the way it is at our house. If your child's playlist has explicit anywhere on it, it's your fault. Because I guarantee you they used your credit card to buy it with. Stop it. Take it away. You know what's right and wrong. You know what they should be listening to and what they shouldn't. Take it away from them. Reality TV. All right. What do you remember watching as a kid growing up?
Cosby Show.
What was it?
Cosby Show.
Cosby Show.
Brady Bunch.
Brady Bunch. Cartoons. Happy Days. All right. How about Gilligan's Island? Anybody watch Gilligan's Island?
Yeah.
All right. All of those. How about Bonanza? Anybody watch Bonanza?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. What is every one of those that we just named off have in common? They're all about wholesome family. All right. Every one of them. Okay. Even the Brady Bunch, which, by the way, the people that thought up Brady Bunch had wisdom beyond their years. Because if you go back to when the Brady Bunch ran, the percentages were deeply changed. The majority of families were not blended families. They were actually still mom and dad living in the same household, same family. So Brady Bunch had wisdom, but it was all about family and wholesome. What do we see today on TV? It's insane. All right? When you look, Teen Mom, 16 and pregnant, Jersey Shore, Keeping Up with the Kardashians, on and on and on. None of that has anything to do with wholesome or family or anything else. It all has to do with destructive. When your kids are watching that, when you walk in the house and your kids are watching it, it's your fault. Because you let them watch it. And I love it, parents will say, I use the parental controls to keep my kid from watching that. My parents' parental controls were on the end of their arms. That's where they were. Because the reality is, A, the kid can probably figure out the parental controls. And B, what are you going to do when they're in a place where there are no parental controls? We want to teach them not to watch that stuff. We want to make them aware of why not. Staying away from the things that just keep them from doing it. All right, let's talk about sensationalism for a minute. Who's the person on the left? Anybody know?
Dusty Rhodes.
Dusty Rhodes. What was his nickname?
American Dreams.
American Dream. That's exactly right. The guy on the front, the one that's being slapped, it's hard to tell who he is because of the way his head's turned. Does anybody know who that is? He's really today who was Dusty Rhodes back then. All right? He was kind of the Dusty Rhodes. Anybody know? Any of our younger audience know? His name is CM Punk. Just the name screams greatness, doesn't it? CM Punk. So the reason this slides in here is one night I came home. I got home a little bit late, and my kid had been watching TV, and he'd been watching professional wrestling. So I went in the kitchen, I fixed myself a sandwich, and they were going to bed, the TV was still on, and I went out there and I sat down on the sofa, and as I'm about halfway down the sofa, that horrible moment in your life happens when you realize the remote's on the other side of the room. And so I had to make a decision, am I going to get up and go get the remote, or am I going to watch what's on? So I just sat there and watched what was on. And I'm glad I did, because what I saw was the second video you're going to see. And it made me think, I let my kids watch this. I allow them to see this. And then I went back and I had our team. I said, I want you to pull me up an old wrestling clip of Dusty Rhodes. The very first one they pulled up and sent to me was the one I'm going to show you. Jeff.
No respect, no honor. There is no honor among thieves in the first place. He put hard times on Dusty Rhodes and his family. You don't know what hard times are, Daddy. Hard times are when the textile workers around this country are out of work. They got four or five kids and can't pay their wages, can't buy their food. Hard took your place, Daddy. That's her.
All right. So the wrestling hasn't changed, all right? But what was he saying? Everything he said in there talked about hard times, talked about no honor among thieves, integrity, all right? All of those things are encompassed in that message. And you know why? Because that was the only message they were allowed to give back then. If they went out of bounds, there were consequences for their actions. Today, there are no consequences. So watch what I watched that night and see the difference.
Teach them a lesson, Paul. Teach them a lesson. Teach them, Paul.
Kids today get the idea to bully somebody at school. I wonder where kids today get the idea to videotape somebody else beating somebody up and putting it up on social media. I wonder where kids today that later become parents think it's okay to beat your child like that because they fathered them or because they loved them. I wonder. Guess whose fault it was that my children were watching something like that? Mine. We have to, right now, start saying, I'm going to be the chief law enforcement officer in my child's life from this day on. They're going to watch what I tell them they can watch. They're going to learn that if they live under your roof, they live by your rules, just like every one of us in this room learned. And you're going to have to accept from me that DCF comes knocks on your door. They're not going to create any problems for you as long as you use responsible in your approach to discipline. All right? So, 1969, you'll notice the parents and the teacher are standing on the same side of the desk. Whose fault was it back in 1969, 1970, if the grades were bad? Kids' fault. Today, the parents and the child are standing on the same side of the desk, and all of a sudden, it's the teacher's fault. Let me tell you right now, there's only one job out there that I believe is tougher than what our team does, and that is being a teacher. If you want to be best friends with somebody, be best friends with your child's teacher. That's who you want to be best friends with. Because they're the one that cares about your kid. They're not making a lot of money to be teachers. They're there because they love it, because they want to help, and because they love your kid. And I promise you, every teacher loves every kid. We have to get back to being best friends with our teachers. When my kids were growing up, I would always take them to school. In fact, I loved it. I wanted to take them to school on the very first day. And I would walk into their teacher, and I would give them my business card. And I would say, if he gets out of line, or she, if he or she gets out of line, call me. And they would always say to me, oh, Mr. Ivey, I'm sure they'll be fine. I'm sure they won't. Right? I'm around them every day at the house. I'm sure they're going to get out of line at some point. And then I would tell them, discipline them and know I'm going to stand beside you. One of my kids, actually my youngest one, Michael, who I've talked about a couple times, Michael had the same teacher 2 years in a row, not because he failed, but because she moved up and started teaching the next grade. And so the first day of school I went in, I walked in, and I started to get my business card out, and she actually, her husband works for us. He's a homicide investigator. She, Ms. Reynolds, pulls out her card, or my card, and says, I got it right here. And I said, keep it, you'll need it. And she goes, I know. And guess what? That was a message to my son. I'm best friends with her. She's the one that's here helping you. Become best friends with your child's teacher. I promise you, it'll take you a lot further. All right, we talked a little bit about what happened when I got in trouble at school. I saw a grandparent in court one day, and it really resonated with me about this program. The grandparent was in court, had actually been arrested because he disciplined his grandson, who he was raising. And believe it or not, even in our community, there are about 800 grandparents that are raising their grandchildren. There's actually 10 great-grandparents that are raising their great-grandchildren. But this particular grandparent was in court because he had disciplined his grandchild. And so the judge came up and has the defendant stand up, and he says, Mr. So-and-so, I understand you disciplined your grandchild because he brought home straight F's on his report card. I'm going to let you have your grandchild back, but before I do, you're going to go to a parenting class. And so the gentleman leans over to his attorney, and he's kind of talking to him. The attorney's shaking his head and trying to calm him down. And finally, the defendant raises his hand and goes, Your Honor, can I speak? And he says, absolutely. I would advise you to listen to your attorney. He goes, no, sir, I just have to ask. And so he says, okay. He says, are you telling me that before I can have my grandchild back, I have to go to a school to learn to be a parent? He said, yes, sir, that's exactly what I'm telling you. And the grandfather said the most profound thing. He looked at the judge. He said, you keep him there. The judge goes, excuse me? He goes, Your Honor, with all due respect, I don't need you to send me to school to teach me how to be a parent. I need you to let me be a parent. The judge is bewildered, called both attorneys up. They talked for a few moments. They went back, and the judge said, Mr. So-and-so, I'm going to let you go ahead and take your grandchild home, but try not to leave any marks on him. That was the reality of it. And it comes down to this. That grandparent was doing everything in his power to raise his grandchild, to teach him right from wrong. And here, this thing gets in the way. And we talk about reasonable in your discipline. The best way I can define reasonable is, A, don't discipline when you're angry. Don't do it. Walk away from it. Discipline is not about anger. Discipline is about teaching right from wrong. That's what it is. No matter how you discipline your child, we'll talk about some of the different ones here in a few minutes, but no matter how you discipline your child, it's designed to teach a lesson, not to inflict pain. That's the whole goal of it. And I always tell everybody, if you spank your kid on the butt, or you whoop them with, what'd you guys get whooped with? What'd you get whooped with?
Belt.
Okay, me too. Anybody else, anything different? Fly swatter. My grandmother was the meanest fly swatter beater I've ever seen in my life, right? Horrible. What? How about you?
Bamboo stick.
A bamboo stick, all right. We had a grape harvest. We had to go cut our own grapevine. All right, it was insult to injury was what that was. Anybody else? Shoes?
Wooden spoon.
Wooden spoon? Okay. Anybody from Hispanic culture in here?
Flip-flop.
All right, so what's it called?
Chancleta.
Chancleta? All right, I see Miguel in the back. Is that what you got beat with, Miguel? Yeah, apparently not enough. That's my guess. I'm just throwing that out. So, chancleta, absolutely. I've heard all of them. But here's what it boils down to. If you're reasonable in your discipline, nobody's going to mess with you. If you kick your kid in the stomach while they're laying on the ground, I personally am coming to get you. Discipline's about being reasonable. It's about teaching right from wrong, not teaching wrong. All right, that's the biggest part of it. All right, let's move on. All right, today's excuses. Single parent. It's the number one excuse we hear. I'm a single parent. I will tell you that being a single parent is probably one of the most unfair things in the world. But you are a single parent. And so instead of saying, I can't do it because I'm a single parent, it has to be your motivation to work harder, to do more, because you're the only parent that is going to help them in their course of life. So instead of being a crutch, it has to become a motivator. You have to work harder. It's unfair, but it is reality. Parent doesn't believe in punishing bad behavior. You have to believe in punishing bad behavior. We talked about it earlier with discipline. You have to. Kids will not listen to me. How many of your kids listen to you? All right. How many of you listen to your parents? Everything they said? No, not one of us. All right. Okay, in fact, we probably only listen to about 50% of what they said. Kids don't always listen, but you have to find that way to communicate with them. You have to communicate with them at their level. Now, that doesn't mean through text messaging, but you have to find a way to break that barrier down. Don't know what else to do. This is a big one we see. Kids or parents get frustrated because they don't know what else to do. In fact, that was really the reason for this program, was to try and offer some tools, to offer some re-empowerment to our parents. I want you to be the chief law enforcement officer. What we see, though, is people don't, there's a lot of different programs out there. I promise you the school probably has some help in that regard. You can call us. We'll be glad to help you. There's a great video that's circulating right now of a child that called the police because the parent had disciplined him, and the mom had used a belt on him. And when the police got there, the deputy, and this is real footage, when the deputy gets there, he's like, so you use that belt on? And they said, yeah, they were doing this and that. And the deputy high fives him and takes the belt and says, I'm gonna leave this with your mom and they're gonna use it on you even more if you don't behave. And they walk away, it's all captured on a body camera. Well, guess what, we're your partners. We're going to side with you if you've done it right. You want us to side with them if you've done it wrong. That's what you pay us to do, is to take care of you. All right, parenting through divorce. Both parents must be in sync. My parents, later in life, they got a divorce. But it didn't change how they raised me. If I was in trouble at my mom's house, I was in trouble at my dad's house. I see so many times today where one parent will hold the child accountable and the other doesn't. We have to make sure that we're working in sync. You may not be able to get along and live together, but you still have a responsibility to do things the right way for your child. So be in sync. Make sure. Kids will play both sides against the middle. Don't let them. They need to know that you're a unified team. Another thing, and I'll back up in just a second. When parents are in sync, one of the things that drives me crazy is either mom or dad will sign the child up to play a sport or to do something. And then the other parent will say, well, that's my weekend. They're not going to do that. That is not your weekend. That is that child's weekend. It's your honor to get to go watch them do the things they're doing. Don't get caught up in the power struggle of, that's my weekend, it's your child's weekend. Let them enjoy it. Let them. You sit up there and enjoy it with them. Kids will play both sides against the middle, we know that. Expectation is at both parents' house. My wife taught me another valuable lesson because our two youngest children are from her first marriage. And when they would go away to their dad's house, and their dad is a good man, he's actually a good parent, but he just has different rules and different ways. And so when they would come back to our house, almost inevitably, I would have to say, where are you at? How do you behave when you're at our house? And my wife and I were talking one day, and she said, you know, I'm not sure that's the right message. And I said, well, honey, we have to get them where they're back in conformity. And she said, I think we need to teach them to behave right wherever they are, not tell them there's a distinct difference in how they can behave. And she was 1,000% right. So make sure that they're understanding you're expected to behave this way all the time. Not when you're at our house, all the time. When you're at the other house, when you're at school, when you're at your friend's house, all along. Next one. Our mistakes. Go ahead. Hurts the discipline? It sure does. But the pain is much deeper and much worse if we don't. Finding balance in what you want for them and what they want for them. How many of you have already decided what your child is going to be? Go ahead. It's all right. You're laughing, so I know you have. All right? Let them decide. Your job as a parent is to support them. Now, if they've decided that they want to be a skydiving artist, you probably need to steer them in a little bit different direction, all right? We probably want to get them closer to something else, but don't try and make them be what you want them to be. My daughter was supposed to be a doctor because I knew I was going to get old and need medical attention. She's not, but she's happy. She's doing what she enjoys. She's doing what she loves. My son, he was supposed to be a school teacher and a wrestling coach. I had that boy on a wrestling mat when he was 4 years old. He could throw a Japanese wizard before he could tie his shoes. He was going to go to college, he's going to be a school teacher, he's going to coach wrestling. It was perfect. He got a scholarship, he went away, he blew his knee out, they sent him home. He's going to what was then BCC, and he was making the worst grades possible. There was a squirrel on campus that had a higher GPA. And I sat him down. I said, son, you're killing me. I'm paying for this now. We're not on scholarship anymore. I said, what's wrong? You're usually a pretty good student. He said, Dad, I don't want to be a teacher. I said, of course you do. You've always wanted to be a teacher. No, you've always wanted me to be a teacher. I said, Robert, we've talked about this. He goes, I don't want to be a teacher. I said, what do you want to do? I said, you want to be an accountant? He goes, Dad, I'm horrible at math. I said, yeah, you are. I said, how about a business degree? He goes, Dad, I'm horrible at math. I said, yeah, you are. I said, how about culinary? He likes to cook. He goes, I thought about that, but not really what I want to do the rest of my life. I said, well, how about drafting? I'm just ABC and going on with this. He goes, let's go back to C for a minute. I said, what? He goes, how about criminal justice? I said, absolutely not. I said, Robert, you'll never make any money as a cop. He said, Dad, you want me to be a teacher? They make less money than cops. I'm like, I hate this kid. But guess what? That's what he wanted to do. I told him, if you're going to do it, you're going to do it on your own. He went and applied, took the test, the ASVAB they have to take, made a 98 on it. He couldn't put two sentences together in the other class, but he made a 98 on that. Took the physical and became a state trooper. He's 33 now. He's the happiest kid you'll ever meet in your life. Well, he's a man now. But it's because he's doing what he loves. Let your children do what they love. Not what you love. Not what you think's good for them. Let them do what they want. Your job is to steer them and prepare them to be successful. That's what our job is. Parents are uninformed on today's resources, especially in the social media area. Sit down and talk to your kids about who they're communicating with. How many of you are on your child's Facebook page? All right? How many of you are on their Twitter account? Make sure you're on everything they have and you have the password to everything they have. If you're not, then they don't get to have it. Now, if you're on Facebook, for example, don't be the parent that goes on there on their Facebook page and posts pictures of them at the Easter egg hunt. All right? That's not the parent I want. But I want you to monitor what they're doing. Your job is to monitor. So they don't keep track of their children. They don't keep track on Facebook. They don't keep track of anywhere they are, whether it's at the house, on playground, or out on the bus. You need to know who they are with at all times. Parenting is the toughest job in the world. It's 365 days a year, 24 hours a day. There is never a day that you're off from parenting. And it doesn't stop when they turn 18 either, does it? Constant parent, all the way through. All right, next page. Our concern today versus yesterday. Passwords, drugs, sexting, bullying, associations. All of those pretty much speak for themselves. And when we look at yesterday, when I was growing up and some of you were growing up, passwords wasn't an issue because we didn't have computers. We didn't have that stuff. But today, they are. We need to have them. Drugs wasn't the issue it is today. Back then, the drug that most kids had access to was what?
Marijuana.
Not even marijuana. Alcohol. That's the drug that most kids had access to back then. Today, that game has changed considerably. And a lot of times, people will say, well, it's not my kid. It's everybody's kids that have the opportunity to do it. You have to worry about your kid constantly. Sexting wasn't a problem back when we were growing up. Bullying on Facebook. Bullying took place on the bus and on the playground back in our day. Today, it takes place on Facebook, on Twitter. The kids never get away from it. They can't. Even used to in our day, you got off the playground and you went, I don't have to worry about that till tomorrow. Today you have to worry about it 24/7 because they're doing it on social media and they're texting and they're doing everything else. So bullying is a strong problem. Associations. Your kids are going to pick friends. Evaluate their friends. Remember, you're the parent. If you don't like the friend, they don't get to have them as a friend. That's just the way it is. You're the parent. You're the one that's going to make those decisions. When should you be concerned? Right now. The moment you wake up, you should be concerned. Changes in behavior, appears withdrawn, angry, depressed, or having mood swings. I just described every teenager on the planet. You know what I didn't describe, though? Your teenager. Because I don't know them. But you do. You know everything about them. You know when one of those things starts to come into play. You know when something's not right. Don't dismiss it. Act upon it. Take it. Loss of an old friendship. This is one that a lot of people miss. You got two kids that have grown up together, played ball together and everything else, and then all of a sudden they get to high school and their friendship goes separate ways. And a lot of times we just assume that, you know, they had different classes and everything else. But what we see a lot of times is that they went different ways because one kid doesn't agree with what the other kid is doing. And so they separate themselves from that. You're never going to know the truth of that because if your kid's the one that's doing wrong, they're not going to tell you. The only way you're going to know is if you and their parents are communicating. I tell everybody all the time, it takes a community to protect a community. It takes a community to raise a child. It absolutely does. You have to be talking to the parents. You have to say, well, this is going on with my child. What's happening with your child? We have to be woven together as a team, not just saying, well, it's not my kid. I don't have to worry about it. When you hear of another child that's doing drugs, you ought to be on the phone to their parents saying, I'm a concerned parent. But we don't. Why? Because we're too worried they might go, oh, you keep your nose out of my business. Well, your business kind of is their business in that regard because their child is impacting your child. Have the conversation. Give them the chance to say, thank you for bringing this to my attention. If they don't, then at least you know you've done everything in your heart you could possibly do. Have that conversation. Talk to our school administrators. Talk to our teachers. Let them know what's going on. You know, if you want to see a gross example of people not communicating, you only got to go 2 hours south to Parkland, because there were missed opportunities after missed opportunities there. Talk to each other. Converse. It's the best way we can protect ourselves. Declining grades are trouble at school. Usually about seventh grade, if we see a child start to struggle in school, what we'll see if that's not corrected is that child will start to look for approval from others. And that approval will be from those that are in the same boat they're in. And they'll start to turn to crime. When we start seeing kids turn to crime, it's usually around that mark, around the seventh grade. And then you go back and you connect the dots and school will start to become a problem for them. If your kids aren't doing well in school, get them a tutor. Do whatever you can. In fact, one of the great tools that I like to see is your kid's not doing well in school, get them a tutor that's in their same class, another student that you know is a good person that can help them through this. All right, you'll be amazed at the difference it'll make when they're with their peers and they're able to learn. Skipping school. How many of you skip school, parents? Come on, be real, throw it up. Wow, you guys are horrible. I can't believe that, all right? I never skipped school, all right? Actually, I never did. I'm telling you right now, I never skipped school. You know why? Because I didn't have to skip school. If I just woke up and I didn't want to go to school that day, didn't happen very often, but if I didn't want to go, I went to my mom and I said, Mom, can I stay home today? I don't want to go to school today. And my mom would always say, you have a test today? No, ma'am. You in trouble at school? No, ma'am, because you know I'm going to call and find out. Yes, ma'am, I know. And then every now and then, my mom would let me stay home. I didn't skip because I didn't have to. All right? Senior skip day. I was at school. My mom and dad said, we're not gonna encourage that. We're gonna have you at school. But my mom understood that sometimes you just don't. How many of you ever had that feeling? I just don't want to go to school today. Even when you're in college, you're like, oh man, I don't want to go to class right now. All right? But I was honest with my parents. I felt like I could go to them and talk to them. But if you see a kid that is skipping school all the time, or you see a kid that is skipping one class, there's a problem going on. There's a problem brewing. You need to get to the bottom of that. And the only way you're going to get to the bottom of it is talk to their teacher, talk to their friends, parents, and everything else, see what's going on. Warning signs of drug and alcohol abuse: physical or mental problems, memory lapses, poor concentration, bloodshot eyes, lack of coordination. Having bloodshot eyes or dilated pupils, using eye drops to mask the signs. How many of you ever bought eye drops when you were a kid growing up? Okay. Those of you that did and just didn't raise your hand, you know why you bought them. All right? The reality is, if you find your child with eye drops and they don't have allergies or they don't have anything like that, there's probably something you need to dig deeper into. Missing money, valuables, or prescription drugs. Keep a track on your prescription drugs. Have their grandparents keep a track on it. Because what we see is when kids start getting into drugs, they'll start going in and taking one or two of your pills that maybe you got because you had back surgery or knee surgery. I know you just went through knee surgery. Keep a track on your pills. Make sure you're putting them where they can't get to them. If you start realizing that some of them's gone, then there's a problem there. And it may not be that your child is doing drugs. It may be your child is being bullied to bring drugs to them. Maybe that your child is now selling them or any of those things. You have to be concerned about it. Sudden weight loss or weight gain. I can tell you my parents never had to worry about sudden weight loss, not once in my life. So, and weight gain, I was just born this big. I mean, that's the way it happened. But look at your child. If you start seeing those symptoms, you know something's wrong. Social media dangers, we've talked quite a bit about how to avoid it. I just want to touch real quick, go to the next slide. Cyberbullying, all right? Emails, text messages, instant messages, cell phone, defamatory personal websites, all of those are probables in your child's life. Go to the next slide, please, Joe. This is the statistic that scares me. 52% of students reported being cyberbullied. 52%. 33 have experienced cyber threats. 25 have been bullied repeatedly through their cell phones or the internet. 52% never told their parents when the bullying occurred. If you're monitoring all of their activities, you'll know the minute it starts to happen. 11% have had embarrassing or damaging pictures taken of themselves without their permission. Those are things that we need to have that conversation with our children about. That effective communicator sits down with them and talks to them about just this. What can you do? Establish open lines of communication. Your child cannot be scared to talk to you. They have to. There's a case out of Tampa that happened about 25 years ago where an 18-year-old girl, actually she was 17 at the time that this happened, got in an argument with her parents about somebody she was dating. They told her that she wasn't allowed to date the person. She said she was going to. When she turned 18, she moved out of the house. She moved in with him. Things started to turn bad. She ended up getting pregnant. She had nowhere to go. And like I said, being a parent doesn't stop at 18, remember that. She had nowhere to go, nobody to talk to because her parents had cut her off. They wouldn't talk to her anymore. He ended up killing her and the baby, and she's never been found. The mom and dad blamed themselves because that baby had nowhere to turn. Don't ever put your child in that position. No matter what they've done, they're the person you love. Let them come talk to you. Let them tell them that there's consequences for your actions, but we're going to work through this. Encourage your child and praise good behavior. We forget the second one, don't we? We quick to jump on our child to say, man, I can't believe you did that. How many times do we look at their report card or something else great they've done and went, man, I can't believe you did that? It's the same words. It's how we deliver them. Praise your child. Let them understand how proud of them you are. I promise you, they'll work toward you being proud of them a lot faster and better than they will away from you being proud of them. They want you to be proud of them. Help your child solve and cope with problems. They're going to have to solve problems the rest of their lives. If you're solving all their problems for them, they're not going to be able to. Help them to understand it. Essentially, what do we want to do as parents? We don't want to let our child fall and skin their knees. We want to keep them from falling. Well, how do you learn? You learn by falling and skinning your knees. You have to be there to pick them up. You have to be there to show them what happened and went bad. But they need to learn to solve problems. Volunteer at your child's school and get involved in their extracurricular activities. I promise you, you will never do anything more important than volunteering at your child's school. Go in, help in the classroom. Go help do all sorts of things. If your child is getting to the age where they don't want you in their classroom, volunteer in the classroom next door. You're still going to be connected. You're still going to have that one-on-one talk with the teachers and everything else. Be involved. Coach. Get involved in coaching. Now, a word of caution, and I say this from my own personal experience. How many of you coach your own kid? Raise your hand for me. All right? I would give you the advice to not. I coached my son from the time he was 4 years old in wrestling. I got to spend a lot of time with him, a lot of great experiences. But when you're the coach of the child can never do enough. I promise you, everybody that's sitting in the stands watching your son on the wrestling mat is saying, that's the coach's son, he ain't gonna lose. The other wrestler is saying, that's the coach's son, he ain't gonna lose. You're saying, that's my boy, he ain't gonna lose. They have nowhere to turn. You wanna coach somebody else's kid and ask them to coach yours. When it comes time for your kid to be on that wrestling mat or on the ball field or wherever it is, in the band, whatever they're doing, you be that proud parent that's sitting up in the stand saying, that's my child. I promise you, you'll enjoy it a lot more. You won't fight with them. You won't be mad with them after the game, everything. Coach somebody else's kid. Sit up in the stands when it's time to do that. Plan family activities without technology. That's not just for the kids. That's for you too. Take your phones off, turn them off, go do something, go on a picnic, go to the beach, go do whatever it is without technology. I promise you, whatever is going to happen will be waiting on you when you get back and you can catch up on the world. But right then and there, your child, your spouse, your family needs to know that they are the most important thing in your life, and nothing's going to separate you from that. You won't regret it. All right, what should I do? Establish expectations and consequences. There are consequences for our actions. Be a good role model. Show understanding, respect, patience, and firmness, and emphasis on firmness. Make sure you're being firm with them. Know your child's friends and stay involved in their friendships. That doesn't mean, let me stop right there, that doesn't mean they're going to the movies, you're going with them. All right, and saying, hey, y'all want to split a popcorn or something? No. All right, that's not what we're talking about. But be involved. Be suspicious. How many of you are suspicious of your children? Anybody? Man, let me tell you something. My kids never had a chance, all right? I was always suspicious of them. How many of you search your children's room? And my children thought they lived at San Quentin. They would come home, I'd shook the room down, stuff was everywhere, and then I would interview them. I'd be like, what's that right there? That's a pencil. Uh-huh. If you pull something over on me, boy, because you can't. All right? Search their rooms. You want them to know it. Be suspicious of everything they do. Stop believing everything they tell you is the truth. This is going to be hard for you to admit, but how many of our parents lied to their parents? Go ahead. It's all right. What makes you think your child won't lie to you? They're no different. They're going to lie to you. That's the nature of being a child. Your job is to catch them. Interview them. Interrogate them. That's your job. I interrogated my children the whole time. I would even do surprise interrogations on them. One time Matthew came home. I'm standing there fixing me a glass of chocolate milk. He walks in. As he walks in, I said, boy, is there something you want to tell me to happen in school today? I got an F on one of my papers. Mm-hmm, I thought so. Go to your room. We'll talk about it. He walked away. I went, I had no clue. None. Just decided to try. Interview them. Interrogate them. Find out the truth, because the truth is what you need to know to be a good parent. Discipline your child and hold them accountable. Don't be afraid to do what's right. And that last part, don't be afraid to do what's right. Disciplining your child is what's right. How you do it is what makes it either right or wrong. You have to do it reasonably. Your actions have to be reasonable. Your need to do it has to be reasonable, not because you're angry. I want you to be the chief law enforcement officer in your child's life. Tonight when you walk out the door, you know, we see parents today, they worry more about DCF knocking on their front door than they do me or one of our team telling them their child's been arrested or their child's been killed in a car wreck. Forget that. Worry about teaching your child right from wrong, and you do it right, and I promise you the outcome will be good. Now, will there be children that it just doesn't work with? There will. All right? There absolutely will. But you have to make sure you can look in the mirror and say, I did everything I possibly could. Because the experience you're going to go through is going to require you to have that. Be innovative in your approach to parenting. It's the last thing I'll say before we bring in the chain gang. Be innovative in how you discipline your child. Your child's 16, picking them up by their arm, busting their butts, probably not going to work. All right? But there are other things that work. Let's say you have a child that loves to slam doors. Take the door off their bedroom. I promise you, they won't slam the door anymore. And they'll get with the program. If your child won't give you the password to their computer, take it from them. If your child won't let you on social media, take all of their social media tools away from them. If your child's driving like a crazy person or doing drugs or drinking alcohol and they drive to school every day, take their car from them. Put them back on the school bus. Whatever it is, be innovative in your approach. There's a lot of different measures out there. The reality is that the time to set the foundation of physical discipline is really at a young age. As they get older, it's about them learning that they lost something because they didn't do what they were supposed to. Those are the things, the tools that you can use. Be innovative. Look at what's really going to have an impact. Now, with that, I challenge you to be innovative, but not like my mom. My mom invented slap yourself, and I'm not kidding. We were going to Fort Myers, or to Sarasota, rather. We were on vacation, me and my two big ox brothers. I'm the smallest of three boys. We're sitting in the back seat. I'm in the middle. Me and my oldest brother are fighting. My mom trying to correct us. She says, she turns around. She can't get to us because of the seatbelt. She looks at my oldest brother, and she goes, Arthur, slap yourself. And me and Arthur both kind of looked at her, and she goes, right now, slap yourself in the face. So my brother slaps himself. She goes, harder. That didn't hurt. So he does it harder. She goes, that is still not hard enough. Do it. And so he does it again. Still not hard enough. Mom undoes her seatbelt, turns around, and slaps Arthur in the face. She looks at me. She goes, slap yourself. I looked at my brother, shook my head. I leaned forward, I'm like, uh-uh. And mom hit me, I thought she was gonna break my neck. I got one slap, he got four. As soon as I heard the seatbelt go click, I looked at my brother, I went, you're an idiot. Click, it's coming undone again, now I was in trouble again. But Don't be that innovative, all right? Take a different approach. My mom actually come watch me do this presentation one time. She was sitting right in the front row. And when I got to the part about slap yourself, my mom put her head down. And literally people were coming up, is that true? And she's like, yeah, it really is. So, all right, so Noah, we ready? All right, so we're gonna bring in the chain gang. And I'd ask everybody to keep their seats. Chain gang is gonna come down the aisles and they're gonna take their seats. You can ask them any question you wanna ask them. There is nothing that's off base. What I want you to glean from them is what went wrong in their lives? What was missing that could have kept them from being where they are today? It's unscripted. I don't have a clue what you're going to ask. I certainly don't have a clue as to what they're going to answer. So I may not always like their answers, to be honest with you. But ask them anything. This is your opportunity to truly, truly get to hear from somebody that I think is a panel of experts about how they got in trouble and stuff. So with that, let's do it, Noel. Get started, I'm going to tell you a little bit about them. You heard me say earlier that they don't have to be here. They're here because they want to be a part of the solution. I'm going to tell you that it takes a lot of courage to stand up in front of people you never met before in your life and talk to them about some things you may have not done right in your life. These guys are here because they want to help. They want each of you to have a chance to keep your kid away from trouble. And I think that takes a lot of courage. And when I first told people that I was going to partner with those out of our jail to try and keep kids out of jail, a lot of people told me I was crazy. When you hear from them tonight, you're going to know I'm not crazy. I may be a little crazy, but not that kind of crazy. So I would just ask that even before we get started, please give them a round of applause. Thank you. All right, so gentlemen, we're going to start out, and we'll just start right here and go all the way down. Please tell me your name, what you're in jail for, how long you have left. How many times have you been arrested?
Right. I'm inmate Tyson. I'm here for grand theft motor vehicle.
There's an on
and off. I'm inmate Tyson. I'm here for grand theft motor vehicle. I got sentenced to a year. I have 2 weeks left, and I've been arrested 3 or 4 times.
I'm inmate Ricks. I'm here on a violation of probation for burglary of a conveyance. I was given 9 months. I have 2 weeks left, and I've been in here 3 times.
I'm inmate Regis. I was arrested for grand theft, sentenced to a year. I got 21 days left. I've been arrested about 3 times.
I'm inmate Henry. I've been in here. Well, I've been here for possession. I got sentenced 6 months. I only have 2 months left. I've been arrested 3 times.
Inmate Caruso, sentenced to 180 days, got caught driving on suspended with a controlled substance, and got 28 days left.
Inmate Best, I'm in for violation of probation for grand theft. I got 8 months, I got 3 left.
Inmate Cother, I've been here for 4 months, I have 4 months left for that. I would be okay on that.
My name is Inmate Wyrick. I'm here for violation of probation, possession of controlled substance. Got sentenced to 9 months. have 3 months left. Been arrested 3 times off of this charge.
Okay. And what was your charge for again?
Violation of probation for possession of a controlled substance.
All right. So, any questions? Let's start out. You can ask anything you want. Yes, sir.
Seems like 3 times, you've all been arrested around 3 times. Is this time going to be any different?
So the question is, a lot of you said you've been arrested 3 times. 3 times is a number of times, obviously. Is when you get out, are you going to get back in trouble again? I guess, is that the best?
Yeah.
So any of you guys can jump on board.
No, sir, I don't plan on coming back. I had probation for 3 years, and I don't have any probation followed. I have a job. I have my family I'm going home to, so I'm getting back on the right foot.
Anybody else?
I don't think any of us are going to try to come back. We're all going to try to change our lives for the better while we're in here and take GED, special classes, and all that good stuff.
All 3 times that I've been arrested are all for the same charge, just a violation. The biggest problem around here is just finding rehabilitation for drug problems. It's easy to get arrested. It's hard to find proper avenues to get help. So now that I've found a lot of proper avenues, especially being in chain gang, being in jail, I've found those avenues. So it makes it a lot easier.
Absolutely. And let me, I'm going to ask you guys a question. I'm going to throw one in because it kind of ties right in. How many of you have been on probation? How many of you violated probation? Okay. So when you're talking to our parents, if their child gets arrested, what would you advise them to do if their child gets arrested?
I mean, I would generally advise you just to tell them to sit the time, think about what they've done, do not take probation, because the success rate of you passing probation is very slim. You can mess up by not answering your door, not answering a call, missing going to probation, being 15 minutes late. It just depends on the officer. So if I were you, I'd tell them just to take the time and think about what they did, and hopefully by the time they come out, they changed who they were.
Anybody else want to weigh in on it? How many of you guys would tell the parents to immediately come bond their child out? Anybody? How many of you would say, let them sit there and let them get taste of it?
That's why I've been arrested 3 times, because I got out quickly the first 2 times, but this is the first time I actually had to sit in jail. So it definitely gives you time to step back and look at what you've been doing.
Okay. I'm going to ask him a second question because I like to evaluate him. Who has the least time? You do, right?
Yeah, I have 2 weeks left.
Anybody got less than 2 weeks? All right, so you're who I'm going to keep an eye on, all right? So. How is the food at the Brevard County Jail?
It's terrible.
let's get him some charges trucked up on him.
It's absolutely disgusting. It's just sometimes you got to mix other things with it just to stomach it.
I take great pride in that, by the way.
Personally, I like the meat mac myself.
I like the chili and rice.
I honestly think it's horrible. It's not good at all.
I've had much better.
I mix it up. I make concoctions.
Come with new diabetes every night.
I'm afraid eating food on the outside, my taste buds have been dumbed down so bad it's not even funny.
What do you get, sir? What are the meals?
Tonight, all right, so what's the meals like?
It's always beans.
What are they?
Today, this morning we had oatmeal, which is pretty, it's like eating cardboard, and then some juice, biscuit, some bologna, and then for lunch you get 2 bologna sandwiches, a bag of chips today, scored on that one. And then tonight we had hot dogs, beans, some salad, and a biscuit. Tastes like eating cardboard again. Get a lot of cardboard.
Excellent. Where's Noel? Noel, make sure that our chef gets an extra pay raise. Doing great. So. All right, another parent. Yes, ma'am.
What was the youngest age of committing a crime? And did you feel you had any support when you chose it? Choice that put you in this position, or you just were in the wrong group? Or?
First question, how old were you when you first got arrested? Just go right down the line.
15.
14.
18.
18.
30-something.
13.
14.
33. Okay. What was missing? I think I'm yeah. over it. What was missing? You're like, what happened? Was it your associates? What led there?
Before I came back to Florida, I was actually living in San Diego. I had a good job making $75,000 a year, working for a company building high-pressure testing equipment. I had to come back to Florida to help take care of my father, who was sick, and I just came back to a town where I had no friends. I had no hobbies. I mean, I think hobbies and a good set of friends are definitely one of the most important things you can have in life. It gives you something to live for. It gives you something to look forward to every day, having a job that you enjoy. And I was lacking that, so I just fell into the wrong group and started using drugs, so.
I would have to say that, yes, I had a big support system. My mom and dad are my biggest support system, but me being boneheaded as I was and stubborn, I pushed them away, which caused me to start hooking up with the wrong group of friends because I felt like they were more for me than the people who loved and cared about me that I know now, so. That's what got me in trouble at 14. Friends.
So let me, and I'll come back to you, but let me just ask this. Was there anything your parents could have done differently that would have changed that?
My parents, they had me under lock and key, which is the best that they could do, you know. When I went to school, I had to make a choice to behave when I was walking, because we live so close to the school. Buses aren't allowed to run when I think you're only allowed to ride the bus if you're within 2 miles, so. I was in within a mile, so I had to walk home. So they had to trust me to walk home also. So, I mean, they put me under lock and key, but I chose to make the choices I made.
I don't blame my parents at all. It's my thing is people, places, and things who I surrounded myself by.
So you say it was your friends? Okay, so that brings up an interesting point. This is mainly for those young ones in our audience right here. All you guys had friends, and I would take it from previous discussions that I've had with other groups like you guys, that your friends helped get you to where you are. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, I hung out with older people. That was my problem.
Okay. So of those friends, those associates that helped get you where you are, and I think we would all agree, you all made your own choices. That was that. But a lot of times who you surround yourself with, my father used to say, if you lay down with dogs, you get fleas. And so using that analogy, how many of your friends have been to visit you since you've been in jail?
Zero. Okay. Zero.
How many of your friends have sent you money to use in your canteen in the jail?
Zero.
Zero. Okay.
How many of them have called your parents to see how you're doing or to even check on you?
Okay. Zero.
So were they really friends?
No, sir.
Okay. All right. And like I said, that's for our young audience. I want you to see that. A lot of times, the people you think are your friends are not really your friends. In fact, what you'll find in life is the people that you didn't recognize were your friends are the ones that'll come and be at your aid. Okay, next question. Yes, ma'am.
What would you say to a parent whose child is struggling, maybe not quite has been arrested yet, but they're struggling? What would you say to the parent, anything that you wish you would have heard?
What would you say to a parent who right now has a child that is struggling, maybe hasn't been arrested yet, but is starting to kind of head in that direction or being defiant in some regard? What would you say to that parent to help them coax that child out of it?
Don't be afraid to ask what's wrong. Just try to figure out the base of the problem, really. Because a lot of the kids try to be secretive about stuff. And you just try to figure it out. That's what I would say.
I mean, I would say that you should, you know, motivate them, make sure they know every day that they can do anything they put their minds to, you know. Just be there for them. If you see they're going through something, ask them what's wrong, like he said. And if they tell you there's a problem going on, try to help them solve it to the best of your ability.
I would say try to keep them, you know, activities and keep their minds moving so they're not so idle and have the chance to do all the wrong things and make the wrong choices.
I would say honestly talk to them and monitor the things that they're doing to try to see if they might be going down the wrong step that you've seen other people or yourselves go down and try to fix those things or try to coach them to go to the right path.
And using the right demeanor to come at them with what you want, you know what I'm saying, with the questions.
say be patient and positive.
That's what I got to say. Be patient and positive and give them a little bit of slack, but not too much slack to where they really hang themselves. And you just keep a close eye on guide them in the right direction the best you can.
I would say the same thing everybody else up here said. Try and keep them busy. Point them in a different direction. Give them activities that they enjoy to keep their minds busy. Keep them doing different things like that.
What else? Yes, sir.
You guys think the first time you were arrested when you were younger, had the legal system been tougher, do you think that would change your outcome? Do you think that would have helped you avoid to get back in jail again second or third time, or be arrested second or third time?
So the first time you got arrested, if the system had been tougher on you, instead of giving you probation and then double secret probation and then community control and double secret community control, if the system had, and if I'm following you right, if the system had, oh, this is it, you're going to pay the consequences, would it have been better for you?
I feel like no, because like people who go to prison, they just get more caught up in drugs and violence. Like the chances of you getting out of prison and actually being successful on staying on the streets is slim to none, because that's all you know. So young people like myself and others, it probably would not have benefited them. It would have hurt them more.
I think maybe a little 60 or 90 day sentence maybe would knock some sense into me a little more than getting out on probation, being able to act up and be hard headed and, you know, continuously mess up. You know, that's what I think.
Yeah, I honestly think that if you got actual time instead of a chance of probation or anything, you're going to try to get out of that jail as quick as possible. So if you had the opportunity of having probation or community control or anything like that, you would jump on that instead of having a few days in there and maybe change your outlook of everything.
Yeah, I think it should be more stricter, because I got basically slapped on the wrist when I first got arrested. It was in and out. I didn't learn anything.
When I was 15, when I got arrested, I thought it was pretty strict, but I got arrested for truancy, hanging out with my friends and not going to school, experimenting with marijuana and hanging with the cool kids. And that just got me arrested again and again and again and again until finally wised up, and it was just a routine over and over and over. Pick different friends. You know, just do the best of your ability to stay away from those people that keep trying to. Hey, come on, let's go do this, let's go do that. And you know the difference between right and wrong. That's all I can say about that. It is strict back then and it's strict now, but it's up to them if they want to do it or not.
I think definitely should be a little bit stricter. I think that if somebody can do a little bit of time, it'll definitely make them realize all the small things that they forget. I mean, a soda. People don't understand all the little things. To have salt and pepper to put on your food, like people take stuff for granted. And I definitely, it's like a catch-22 on the other hand, though, because if you come out of jail with a felony, it makes it hard to get a decent job and all those things. And like, luckily, I can say I have an adjudication withheld, which makes it a lot easier. But still, it's a catch-22. But I definitely think that they should be stricter at first. They should just offer a short sentence instead of probation, because probation can be hard for somebody who's already messing up.
So you said you don't realize the things you miss until you don't have it. You guys, just real quickly, and especially for the benefit of our younger audience, what else you have in jail? What's the first thing you realize you don't have in jail?
Privacy.
Okay. So, I mean, like if you go to the bathroom and stuff, there's privacy, right?
No, there's 5 other guys walking in and out. There's a guy over here on the other side of the wall taking a shower. I'm sitting with a little wall right here. Another guy's going to the bathroom. Another guy's using the urinal. So
how about, condiments? Like ketchup, mustard?
Get mustard sometimes.
Okay. Salt and pepper?
Salt.
TV? Really? How about telephone? You can use a telephone all the time, right?
Cost $7 for one phone call.
Okay. And who pays that? The person you're calling, right?
Yep.
So they're not very likely to pick up the phone, are they?
Right.
Okay. All right. Next question. Yes, sir.
Can you explain to them, they were asking what, how the probation works and
what is it,
how it works?
Yeah, so I'll explain it, and I'll let one of these guys. Probation is you get arrested for something, and instead of doing jail time, they put you on probation, which means you may get 6 months, a year, whatever it is. If you do all the things you're supposed to do, in other words, you behave throughout that, you make it out, you don't have to go to jail. If you violate, and there's a lot of different ways to violate, if you violate that, then you're going back to jail, and a judge decides if you get out and get another chance. Best way to put it is, it's like you're on restriction, and when you violate your restriction, you get a longer restriction, or you get a deeper punishment from it. Now, the different things that you can violate for, not having a job is called a technical violation. Don't pay your probation fines or fees, that's a separate one. What else? What am I missing? That? Restitution to the victim.
You don't answer your door. They come to your door every 30 days if you don't answer the door. And sometimes they ask to search your house, and you being on probation, you have to legally let them search your house, which means you can't argue with them because that's a technical violation.
Being late for work, that's the reason I violate.
Being late for work? Yeah, so. And when these guys say that it's hard to make it off probation, having heard people in similar chairs that they're in before, if I was in trouble and they said you can either do 6 months in the jail or do probation, I think I would do the 6 months in jail.
I'm definitely doing the 6 months in jail.
Yeah, you know, because then it's behind you and you can start doing it. Now, the problems with that, like you said, now you're coming out of jail, you got a criminal history, you've been in jail, a lot of places won't hire you. They won't do that. We've just, I don't know if any of you guys have taken advantage. Have any of you done the OSHA training? All right, so we talked with the Home Builders Association. Contracting's through the roof right now. They're building homes and businesses and everything else. Their problem is they can't find people to work. They can't find laborers. So when we heard that, we went in and said, the number one thing you need to get a job on a contracting site is OSHA training. It's level what, 1 and 2, I think it is.
OSHA 10.
OSHA 10, yeah, so OSHA 10. So you can't even get a job until you have that OSHA 10. So what we started doing in partnership with the Home Builders Association is offering them, if they want it, the OSHA 10 training. And so they go through the training. Now when they walk out the door, we also have a list of employers that will give them a job right now. Because if they can get out and get a job and get self-supported and get back on their feet, there's a much less likely chance of them coming back in here. So we just started that program probably, 6 months ago, maybe?
On top of that, they also have GED programs in jail. We have two guys here that just got their GED and yeah, two more that are working on it.
And that's a great point, too. How many of you guys have a high school diploma? How many of you have a GED?
I do as of yesterday.
As of yesterday. Congratulations. How many of you have a college degree? Anybody have a college degree? Okay. So that's a great point. We have all sorts of programs in there that we're trying to get them the tools they need. Maybe they need drug rehab after they get out, or they need a place to live. All of those things we're trying to help them get. The way you lower your crime rate is by being aggressive on the front end and trying to take those that are committing crimes off the street. The second part of it is, if you can find those people that have been to jail a way to be productive in society, then they lower the crime rate. And if you notice, we just put it out Sunday night, our crime rate in the past 6 years has dropped 30%. 30%, and a large part of that is because we have a partnership with you, where you're helping us solve crimes, you're helping us prevent crimes. All of those three things work in concert with each other. What's next? Yes, ma'am.
Curious, for the gentleman who was arrested for grand theft auto, why did you steal car number
where did you steal the car?
In essence, yes.
In essence, yes. Miguel, is that a confession?
Allegedly. I pled guilty.
All right, so why did you steal the car? What?
It was because of drugs. When I was high and I rationalized me using someone else's car. It wasn't like I went up with a gun and took someone out of someone's car. It was just a car that I happened to know where the keys were at. And I just didn't want to walk, I guess.
All right, so I got to ask the question, follow up. What kind of car was it?
It was a Honda. wasn't nothing serious. I'm not, I wasn't.
Come on, man. You went to jail for a Honda?
Nah, it wasn't like that, though.
I got a BMW or something. All right, what next? Let me go here and I'll come up there. She wants to know if you ever played Grand Theft Auto.
All the time.
There we go, right? All right, yes.
So, when y'all were growing up, was religion a part of your life?
When you were growing up, was religion a part of your life?
No, my mom and dad do not believe in the church, but at 15, I decided to go to church myself. I decided to give it a shot, and from there, it got better. But as I turned 17 and 18, I stopped going, and that's when I started seeing myself slip down the path. Or at that time, I didn't see myself slip down. Now that I've sobered up and tried to change who I am, you get to step back and actually think about what you were doing and what led up to where you're at now.
No, religion wasn't a part of my family's life. They were too busy working to have pretty much any involvement with anything me and my brothers were doing.
No, religion wasn't a part of my life. I've kind of lived a hard life, so it just, I didn't really look at God or anything like that. So once I like became getting in trouble and everything, I started praying a lot to God. And it actually changed my life around and everything like that.
Religion did become part of my life before I came in. I was going to church, actually.
No, it was not a part of my life.
It was an on and off going.
I've never been a religious person, either as my family, not growing up.
Just as a follow-up to that, how many of you have had an opportunity to have the ministry delivered to you and are here?
I go to church every Sunday with our pastor. They have a good pastor that comes in every Sunday, and I think there's one that comes in for Bible study on Saturdays. And they're both really good. They minister to us, and then they have a chaplain that comes in and gives us calendars, and they give us things we can work through the Bible with, like a Bible correspondence, and if we finish it, we get a nice looking Bible. But it helps us to open up our word, and when we get out, hopefully stay in that word.
What's next? Yes, ma'am.
Do any of you feel like when you were younger that possibly you had any type of learning disability or any neurotypical autism or anything else that might have led you to have poor processing and making bad decisions as you got a little older?
Or didn't have the support when you were younger? As you were a kid growing up, did you ever have any type of learning disabilities or attention deficit disorder or autism, Asperger's, anything like that?
I mean, I'm ADHD, I'm ODD, I'm classified bipolar, and emotionally handicapped. So, yes, it kind of, it makes you not be able to think sometimes, and you really got to find a way to step out and be able to think about things. But it's hard when your ADHD and your ODD kicks in, and then when you get angry and you react on a on just an instance or a thought, that can really mess you up too. And that's where the bipolar kicks in.
What's next? Anybody else? Yeah, actually, there's two programs that we offer, and if you want to, you can talk to Miguel and Carissa right afterwards. Two programs that we offer. One is historically, agencies stopped doing jail tours. They didn't do them anymore. I started it back. I think parents need to have that as a resource if they want to be able to take and you know, let their kids see what it's like. The second one is a program called BAM. And it's Brevard Attitude Modification. It's a full day, starts out going in front of a judge who asks the kids what they're there for. So it's always comical to me because there'll be 15 kids lined up. The judge will ask the first one, why are you here? And that kid will be like, man, I don't know, they brought me, pointing to their parents. And the judge just rips into them. The second kid, when the judge says, why are you here? They're like, because I'm a little snot and I'm very lucky that my parents brought me here. So thank you very much. That day starts out that way, and then throughout the day, they get a little taste of what jail's like. It's not a scared straight program. I do not think scared straight was a successful program because it only taught one element, to be scared. Once the kids get past that, there's nothing to stop them. So this program is about, this is what happens if you make bad choices, and then at the middle of it, there's two arrows on the floor, painted on the floor. One says bad choices and goes back to where they just came from. The other one says good choices. I stand in between the two arrows, and they have to tell me that they're going to make good choices in their life. And then we take them into a different environment where they get to see what happens when you make good choices. They get to learn how to go on a job interview. They get help filling out a resume. There's employers that will hire them right there if they're old enough and put them to work from it. So it's designed to show you the two different things. These guys are actually involved in those programs when we do them, and they meet the kids as they're coming in. They've got their blankets, and they've just been put in their uniforms, and these guys actually meet them and talk to them about what's gone wrong in their life. They don't yell at them. In fact, when we first started the program, I met with what was then the chain gang a few years ago, and my idea was for them to come in there and get in their face and get in their grill and everything else. And we met in a classroom, and the chain gang educated me. They said, Sheriff, we don't think that'll work. Let us sit down and talk to them. Let us sit down and have a conversation about how our lives are right now. And so we went with their option, and they were right. It's much more effective when these guys sit down on the edge of a bunk with them and start telling them what life is about and what's happening. So if you're interested in either one of those two programs, please get with Miguel and Parissa over to your right, and they'll get you the information to sign up for.
Sheriff?
Yes, ma'am.
This is kind of a dual question in the sense that friends and I have been trying to find places to take our kids to volunteer, and I know the school does a lot of volunteer stuff, but it's like building houses and silly stuff. Like, not that that's silly, but
no, sure, I'm sure.
Like you were talking about when we were young, my brothers put roof on the church, you know, I mean, hard work. And we cannot find anything that will allow children our kids' age to do anything, which leads me back to these guys. You know, when you were 13, maybe if your parents took you to some volunteer thing every once a month or twice a month or whatever to be with people that actually are struggling or figuring things out, would that have helped you?
Did any of you guys do any volunteer work when you were a kid growing up, or any of your parents have any community activities? Or?
I actually did Explorers.
Explorers? Okay.
I was in Scouts, so I did a lot of volunteer work.
Okay. And to speak to your thing about being tough to find these days, it is. So many people have now become more worried about civil liability than they have anything else. So let me take two more questions, and then I'll take you two right here, and then I'll close out.
How many of you were bullied, or did you bully someone when you were young?
How many of you were bullied when you were growing up? Any of you? Okay. And how many?
Yeah. I used to be 360 pounds. I was a fat kid when I was younger, so definitely. Yeah.
I'm right there now.
Yeah, they don't see me now.
That's right. How many of you bullied somebody? Anybody bullied? Okay. To those of you that raised your hands, did work impact you?
It does impact you because you start to feel like a lone wolf, as they call it. You start feeling like you're not part of a group, and you want to, and you look for that acceptance from the group, and that's what can cause, you know, you to start getting into the circle with the wrong friends when you should be trying just to be yourself. A lot of kids just lose themselves and trying to be in with the cool kids, doing things with the cool kids, being part of that clique, and it's not what it needs to be. You need to worry about yourself and stay, if you have to, stay to yourself. It's the best thing you can do at this point.
I was bullied by my father also.
By your father?
Yeah.
Okay. And how impacted was that? How many of you have a good relationship with your parents now?
My mom's my best friend.
Your mom's your best friend? Okay. All right. And I'll take one last question.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I'm impressed with everybody's introspection. I don't know if it's because you had a lot of time to think about where things went wrong, but are you confident now that you've got the tools that you need to be successful and not go back to jail?
Yes, sir. I mean, I got my GED. That's the first step in getting into a college or doing it with your high. Actually, technically, it's a high school diploma. It reads a high school diploma from the state of Florida. And it gives us the ability to enter a college or to enter a trade school or to do what we want to do, start our own business. You know, just that's part of one of those legs that you need to get further into life. And They offer more than just GED. They offer anger management for people who are bipolar like myself. That helps me be able to find a way to cope with the anger or find a way to control it. You know what I'm saying? And I mean, yeah, the jail really does offer a lot of tools that'll help us to get back on our feet and try to be the best people that we can be. We do a lot of volunteer work, which gives us a chance to not hurt the community instead, but to help the community. And it makes us realize that we can be a part of everybody else, and it doesn't matter what other people say we are.
How many of you, I know you do, anybody else get their GED while they were in jail? I'm working on it. You're working on it?
I'm also just getting one more test.
One more test?
Yes.
And how much more do you got?
I just started.
Just started?
Okay.
Do you want to add on to that?
Oh, no, I was just going to say, you were talking about, you know, do we have the proper tools to make it? Until you hit rock bottom, you really don't know that you need to turn things around. Like me, I know there's a few guys on here, like, I was using heroin, and I didn't really think that it was that bad until I ended up in the hospital and almost died from infections and stuff like that. Then I realized that I needed to find avenues, and I probably could have finished my probation, but I realized that I needed the clean time. I wasn't getting the correct avenues, so I took the time, and it's definitely gave me the tools that I need to make it through. So,
I'm gonna share a statistic with you, and it kind of ties right into what your question was. In the Brevard County Jail, the recidivism rate for male inmates is 44%. So 44 out of every 100 are coming back to jail within the first year, unless they've been a member of the chain gang. And that recidivism rate is zero. Okay, now, the reasons I believe for that are, one, these guys get to rethink, like you said. They get to be a part of a lot of positive stuff. They go into an area that just looks nasty, and when they leave, it looks beautiful. They get to be a part of this program. They get to be a part of the BAM program. They get to work together as a team. They have to work together as a team because they've got chains on their ankles. They get to rethink it. And, you know, I used to coach high school wrestling. And if I wanted a kid to improve in technique, I would have that kid teach somebody else how to do the move. Because to do it, they had to break it down again and rethink it and do it all over again. Well, these guys are getting a chance to rethink it and break it down. They get to go be around the dogs at our kennels and the different things. So all of those positive things feed in. It's not because they're out on the side of the road picking up trash. That's not what lowers the recidivism rate. It's all the things they learn along that roadway is what I believe. And you guys can correct me if I'm wrong because you're living it.
I believe it's about making a change. Like, doing all these things, doing all these positive things, it shows that we can change ourselves as a person.
How do you get selected to be on the chain gang?
Who gets selected to be on the chain gang? They actually volunteer to be on the chain gang. Last I knew, we had a waiting list. Is that still accurate? We have a waiting list wanting to be. They get to go outside. They get to be involved in a lot of stuff. Tonight, against my better judgment, or I don't know, are we doing it tonight with food, or is it going to be tomorrow?
Tomorrow
they'll get some pizza or something. It drives me crazy. They volunteer to be on it. And I think that feeds into as well of taking that first step to the next chapter of their life. So I'm going to close out by asking them two questions, and I'll go right down the line. What food do you miss the most?
Hot wings.
Tacos.
Steak. Chicken wings.
Seafood?
Chicken,
barbecue, cow's
out. It's always the big guy thinking about food. All right, so my last question for them, and then I'll close out. Who's your hero?
My grandmother.
Grandmother.
My father.
Father.
My great-grandmother.
My grandmother.
My brother-in-law.
My dad.
My father. My brother that passed away.
Okay. You're somebody's hero. Act like it. Heroes save the world, all right? Not one of them said their hero was some influential person in the community or influential person in the country. It's the person that's closest to them that is their hero. Now, I like to always take it a step further. Who's your hero? Who's your hero? Dad, Joe?
You sure?
Noel? Dad? Miguel? Mom? Prison?
My brother.
Brother. So the reality of it is when you look at the hero, they're the person that's closest to you. Tonight, you become your child's chief law enforcement officer. All right? As law enforcement officers, we hold people accountable. As law enforcement officers, we help people. And as law enforcement officers, we often know that what we're doing every day of our lives is impacting somebody. So the last thing I would ask you to do, as I told you, it takes a lot of courage to be these men on this stage. I would please ask you to stand up and let them know how much you appreciate them. Thank you again so much, Dr. Ferrer, letting us be here tonight. Thank you guys for being here tonight. I apologize we went a little long, but I wanted you to hear from these guys and the things that they had to say. So with that, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you very much for the amazing program. I think it's impacted each one of us in a special way. So if we can all be better parents because of what we saw and heard today, God bless you. Thank you very much.
Yes, ma'am. Have a good night, everybody.
Thank you.
All right, what are we getting in there?